How is your Japanese, Taiwanese, and Russian?
That's money.
It's good.
On point.
On point. Okay. He can speak all three languages.
Kimchi vodka.
Yes! There we go! It's done. He can speak all the languages.
In this week's episode of Going Ike Raw, we're on my home turf, the Tidal Delaware River. What a great way to end this amazing fishing traveler trip. Before we get into the show, I want you to take a second. If you're not already subscribed, hit that button right there. Smash that subscribe button and subscribe for all the great videos we have coming every week. You know, when I plan this out with the fishing travelers, trying to plan world-class fishing destinations in the Northeast, you know, one that I wanted them to experience before they left was my home fishery. And you always take pride in that because it's, you know, it's your place. The Delaware River, the Tidal Delaware River around Philadelphia is basically the place I learned how to fish, from before I could even hold a fishing rod to now, over 40 years of experience fishing this place. And it's a challenging fishery, it's a tough fishery, but I'm proud of it. So I couldn't think of a better place to end this tour for the fishing travelers than right here at home, right here on the Delaware River in Philadelphia.
There we go, folks at home, folks at home. Last day of the fishing adventure. Yes. And we're on the Delaware River. Delaware River, guys.
Yeah, yeah. Check it out, yeah. Okay.
Day number four of our adventure. Are you excited?
Exciting. Finally, we can take the phone, the really, really pro ball. Everyone wants to do this one.
Bass
How
boat.
Luck we
Tournament.
Are.
Tournament.
Ball. Tournament bass boat. Yeah. Okay.
And champions boat.
Here
champions
we go. Ball. Yeah. All right. Yeah, it's going to be a good day.
You know, basically we drove from my house to the ramp, which is on the New Jersey side, straight across from Philadelphia. And for this one, I needed a second boat. And with me on this trip was my buddy Rich. And Rich has a full-size bass boat as well.
And look who we got over here. Mr. Rich, a.k.a. Riz, a.k.a. Rizzo.
What's up?
He's been at the ramp since 4:30 this morning, and we're late as usual. Nice thing about being the host of this trip, I get to blame it on my guests.
Yeah, that's right.
They overslept.
Yeah.
Even though it was me, I'm blaming on them. Rich, thoughts about today? Give me your thoughts. Tide, conditions, temperature. What are your thoughts?
The tide is going to be very good. We're going to have good outgoing water to start the morning. Should have about 2 hours of a falling tide. And as you know, on the Delaware River, low water is good water.
Yep.
The water temperature should be getting ideal to start really catching them good. And I don't think we're going to have too much wind, so we're going to be able to run around, cover some water. Should
All
be
right.
fun.
Good day. We're going to cover a lot
Never
of water.
Had this many cameras.
One last question. How is your Japanese, Taiwanese, and Russian?
That's money.
It's good.
On point.
On point. Okay. He can speak all three languages.
Kimchi vodka.
Yes! There we go! Yeah. It's done. He can speak all the languages. Yeah. Okay.
I can tell you, as soon as they got there, these guys, you could see it on their face. They were sort of nervous. This was a look that I haven't seen yet from these guys. And I wonder, what's this all about? Why are they looking nervous? And then, as we're putting the boats in, I realized that they have never been on full-size bass boats before. This is going to be their first time in a bass boat going 60, 70, 75 miles an hour on the water. They're in for something. We're running running down the river, and it's unbelievable to see their faces. They're scared, they're excited, they're nervous, all at the same time. You can see Shota holding on. You know, they're holding on for dear life. We're hitting waves. They feel like they're getting thrown out, and they're taking in the scenery of this tidal fishery. You know, this part of the Delaware, it's industrial, and you've got factories and seawalls and giant seagoing ships and barges. It's unbelievable. This is what you call city fishing. And they're wrapped up in that. And I love it. It's something that I still enjoy. I've been doing it a long time, but I totally get why they're excited by this. But we make a short run, probably only a 20-minute run, and we're gonna start doing something on the Delaware that I call running and gunning, or running the tides. And basically that means stopping to fish a spot, hitting the key stretch, fishing for 15 or 20 minutes, making a move. Running up the river, hitting another spot, making a move, making a move, making a move. And we're doing that to maximize our time, but we're also doing that to stay with the best water, which on the tidal Delaware is low water. You always want the lowest outgoing tide you can get. The fishing is definitely not great. You know, in a couple spots in, right away we get a feeling that this is tough because it's transition time. Transition time on the Delaware means fish moving from their fall pattern to their winter pattern. And we're trying to intercept these fish as they move into their wintering holes. We're throwing mainly power fishing baits and finesse fishing baits together. So spinner baits, vibrating jigs like a chatterbait, and then small jigs and small worms. And we're gonna start this day off fishing for bass, specifically largemouth bass. I wanna say about 30 minutes in, you know, we start getting our first few bites and they're coming on a chatterbait. These are nice sized Delaware bass. And a good sized bass in the Delaware, it's not 5, 6, 7 pounds. 2, 2.5, 2.75. That's a big one on the Delaware. So we're getting some bites, but it's tough. And these guys, you know, after the 3 trips we've had, these guys are expecting big things, and this is gonna be a tough day on the Delaware. Before we know it, that tide turns. And when the tide turns on the Delaware and that water starts coming back up, a lot of times the bass will shut down. And one of the reasons is because not only is the water getting higher, but it's bringing in dirty water. That muddy water coming off those banks as the water rises tends to shut the largemouth and smallmouth down. So we decide to make a move, and we're going to run up a tributary of the Delaware called the Schuylkill River. You know, the neat thing about the Schuylkill, it's this very windy, snake-like river, and it literally runs up through downtown Philly. Skyscrapers in the back, bridge pilings, all the way up to the Art Museum, right below the falls. And in this area, we can catch different species. There's the potential up here to catch smallmouth, striped bass, hybrid bass, snakehead, but there's definitely a chance we're going to catch a lot of really big channel catfish. This is literally the spot where I learned how to fish. The upper end of the Schuylkill, right behind the Art Museum. This is where my uncle and my grandfather used to take me catfishing when I was like this big, when I was 3 or 4 years old. So, you know, it's a great feeling for me because it's all come full circle. To have the fishing traveler guys with me is awesome, and I want them to experience this. You know, we fish some bridge pilings and it's slow, but we get up to the falls. And the falls are special. And the falls are special because it's a continuous dam where water dumps over the upper Schuylkill into the tidal section. And if you think about that, what you have there is you have a constant flow of water, no matter what the tide's doing, a constant flow of water, oxygen, bait fish, along with a really deep little washout hole right where that water comes in. And it's the perfect spot in the fall, early winter to find fish. You know, we start fishing and I make a change to one of my favorite fish catching baits for all around fish catching, and it's gulp. And Berkeley makes this product, and it's a little minnow shape. It's a 3-inch gulp minnow, and you can rig it on a jig head. We're rigging it on a drop shot, a lot of different ways to fish it, but it really mimics the small minnows and shad that those fish are feeding on. The other great thing about the gulp is it stinks. It's got this horrible smell. And for catfish, there's nothing better.
Big one.
Every couple minutes, somebody was getting a bite. Shota's catching it. List is catching it. I look over, Max is hooked up. Peter's hooked up. For about an hour there, we just nonstop catching them. Channel catfish from a pound and a half up to 7 or 8 pounds. This is fun fishing, and it's another chance for these guys to experience a different species, a different bucket list fish. And for most of these guys, this is the first American channel catfish they've ever caught. You know, after a while fishing for these catfish, we make a decision. We're gonna swap partners and we're gonna change up. Peter's gonna jump in my boat and we wanna try one more thing. You know, we look at our watch, we got maybe 2 hours, 3 hours left, and we've caught bass, we've caught catfish, and now we're gonna try for Delaware River tidal stripers. You know, even though we've already caught some stripers, these stripers in the Delaware are vicious because they're battling current. You're catching them on light tackle, you're catching them around pilings and bulkheads and rocks. And you know, we really want to end this day with a bang if we can get into some of these fish. So we leave the Schuylkill, we make a big run down, and we go south. And now we're headed to what I call sort of the line where it changes from freshwater to saltwater. This is sort of that brackish line between the Commodore Barry Bridge and the Delaware Memorial Bridge. And it's the perfect spot where these stripers, you know, from 2 to 3 pounds up to 10 or 15, they live all year round. You know, migratory stripers will come up and spawn and go back to the ocean. But these juvenile, young, mature fish, a lot of times will stay in the river all year round. So we decide to make this run, try to end this day with a bang. We get there and Rich starts on one, I start on another, and right away Rich hooks up. The other boat hooks up with a really nice big one, probably 8 or 10 pound class striper on a spinner bait on bass tackle. About 5 minutes later, I hook up with a big one. This one's on a chatterbait, white chatterbait imitating a shad. It's another big one, probably a 10 pound class striper. Man, this is a great way to end the day. And at one time or another, we're all hooked up on really, really nice stripers. From 4 or 5 pounds up to 10 pounds, spinner baits, vibrating jigs, small swim baits. It's awesome. And to let these guys experience it at the very last hour of the last day that they're in the States, to have them fight these vicious fish, it's awesome. You know, it's starting to get dark. I look at those guys and we're all exhausted. We've had 4 straight fishing trips from Pulaski, New York for salmon to the mouth of the Connecticut River for stripers, blues, togs, and sea bass to Harrisburg, Pennsylvania for giant smallmouth. And finally, last but not least, to my home fishery, the tidal Delaware River. It's been an unbelievable trip, but we're tired. These guys have to wake up the next morning. They're all flying back home. Japan, Taiwan, Russia. It's gonna be a long trip for them. I couldn't think of a better way to end it than right here on the tidal Delaware River. I want to thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this last series of the Fishing Traveler Going Ike Rawls. But guess what? There's a lot more coming. And if you want to keep up with all the Going Ikes, Going Ike Rawls in the shops, click right there. Click on that subscribe button and stay up to date on videos each week. I hope you enjoyed the show. I hope you enjoy the videos to come. Have a good one. For information on the product and gear used in the show, go to MikeIconelli.com and follow me on my social feeds at MikeIconelli. And if you want to help grow the sport of fishing, get kids involved. Go to theIkeFoundation.org to figure out information on how you could help get involved in getting kids fishing.